Yes, thank you to the organizers for inviting me to speak at this conference, and also for for the organizers of the trimester, which has been wonderful. So I want to talk about dimension and automorphisms in the differential field of trend series. So this is a topic that sort of arose in the wake of our model completeness theorem. And as we'll see, these two topics, dimension and automorphism, are in fact related. And they sort of arise if you ask finer questions about the nature of definable sets in this structure. And as we'll see, some very interesting model theoretic, very strong model theoretic phenomena that usually don't happen in real life manifest themselves in this structure. So what are trend series? Well, so trend series are formal series with real coefficients multiplied by monomials. And these monomials are can be pretty complicated. So they can be real powers, but they can also be exponential terms or logarithmic terms. And they can even be, as you'll see in the last example, exponentials of other trend series. So what's here in the background is a sort of an inductive construction that I'll hint at later. but at the moment, I think one should simply look at an example to get an idea of what such a trend series can look like. So you see here that the order type of the support, so to speak, can also be pretty complicated. It can be any countable ordinal. So I think here of X as a positive infinite element. And I think of these trend series as representing asymptotic expansions, if you want, of functions at plus infinity. One shouldn't take this literally, but I mean, that's that is the reason for trend series, the reason for their existence. These trans monomials here are arranged from in decreasing order. So there's a largest one, and then they go down from there. Okay. So formally, if you want to construct the trend series, the construction is a bit involved. It arises as an ordered subfield of a Hahn field for a very large group of monomials. We had this discussion about the additive versus multiplicative notation. So I'm sticking here with the multiplicative notation, which is more natural, I think, in this context if you think about monomials. So this trend series field is itself not a Hahn field, but it's a subfield of such a thing. So I'll talk a little bit about Hahn fields because they come with a notion of infinite summation, which is usually not stressed that much in valuation theory, but which is quite important for us. Okay, so here's the plan. So I'll talk a little bit about Hahn fields, then about T, and then, as promised, about dimension and automorphisms of T. Okay, so Hahn field. So let's start with an ordered abelian group written multiplicatively, and think of these guys as monomials. Then we call a subset S well-based if there is no infinite increasing sequence in this subset. I think of a function taking values in the reals defined on M as an infinite series. Such a series then has a support. If I collect all those functions whose support is well-based according to this definition, then I get a subspace of the space of all functions. Now, because the support of such a non-zero series is well-based, it has a largest element, and I call this the dominant monomial of the series. And I write this with as D of F. And then the ordering on M can be extended to a comparison relation on this set of series by simply comparing the dominant monomials. Now, This is not just any old subspace. You can actually add and multiply these series in the natural way, as you would add and multiply power series. There's a little bit to check here. You need to check that according to this definition, on the right-hand side, you still end up with a well-based series. So you need to prove a few lemmas about well-based sets that guarantee this. So you get an R algebra. In fact, you get a field. And this is known as the Hahn field. Well, if you also turn it into an ordered field, so because I have this dominant monomial, I can declare a series to be positive if it's non-zero, and the leading coefficient, the coefficient of the dominant monomial, is positive. So then I get an ordered field, and this is what I call a Hahn field. Okay, so what about this notion of infinite summation? Well, this notion is quite natural. You simply declare a family of series in a Hahn field to be summable if, first of all, if you take the union of the supports of all the series in the family is well-based. And for every monomial, there are only finitely many indices where this monomial appears in the support of the series. And if that is the case, then you can define the sum of this family simply by, well, in the way that, oops, that is indicated here. Let me try with that, yes. Right. Okay, so, well, of course, you know, if you look at a series and you look at the family consisting of the coefficient times the monomial, well, that is summable, and its sum is f, as you would expect. But here is a more interesting example. So if you have a series where all the monomials are strictly bounded by 1, then if you look at f to the n, then this series here is summable. And in fact, the sum turns out to be 1 over 1 minus f. And well, there's something to check here, right? I mean, you need to check that these conditions here are true. And this is known as Neumann's lemma. well, showing this is one of the crucial steps in proving that the Hahn field is a field. Okay, and so this notion of summability has various nice properties, which I won't explain in detail here. But for example, you can rearrange the summation in any way that you like, and its summability is preserved, etc. Okay, now, as I said, T is an increasing union of Hahn fields. So I want to define what a directed union of Hahn fields is. So let's say we have a family of ordered subgroups of our group M, whose union is M. And let's assume that this family is directed, right? So that whenever I have any two of these groups, there's a third one that contains both of them. Well, then you obtain an ordered subfield by taking the corresponding union of the Hahn subfields of Rm. okay, and these are the directed unions that I want to consider. Now, here's a technical definition that's useful later. So an ordered subgroup S of M is called a K subgroup. If I look at series which have monomials in this ordered subgroup, I never get out of K. Okay, and then, well, if I have this this notion of directed union, I can also define a corresponding notion of summable. I can simply say a family in K is summable if there exists a K subgroup over this K subgroup contains all the elements in my family, and it's summable as a family in that Hahn field. Okay, so we have the notion of a directed union of a Hahn field, and we have the notion of summability for families in directed unions. Okay, and then once you have the notion of summability, there's also an appropriate notion of linear map that preserves summability, so we call this strongly linear map. So a map, an R linear map from K to K is called strongly linear if whenever you have a summable family in K, then and you apply phi, then you get a summable family in K, and phi commutes with the with this infinite summation. Okay, so well, one example is, for example, multiplication. So if you fix an element G and you look at multiplication by G, that is a strongly linear map. Okay, and then not only have do you have strongly linear maps, but the kernels of strongly linear maps are strong subspaces. So what is a strong subspace? Well, it's an R-linear subspace which is closed under infinite summation. Right, and so yeah, as I said, if you take the kernel of a strongly linear map, then that is a strong subspace. And well, then also the fixed point set is a strong linear subspace because it's the kernel of this strongly linear map. And this is going to be important later. Okay, so this was sort of the technical preliminaries. So now let me talk about T. So first, let me talk about exponential ordered fields. So an exponential ordered field is, for me, simply an ordered field equipped with an exponentiation. So this means an embedding for the additive ordered additive group to the multiplicative group of ordered multiplicative group of positive elements, and I call this a log exp ordered field if this is an onto map. And of course, the standard example is the usual real field with exponentiation. Now, the Hahn field with where the monomial group are the real powers of x can never be turned into a log x ordered field. So it's way too small. So in order to remedy this, one constructs T by extending this small Hahn field into a very large field of into a very large log x ordered field T. And one does this in two steps. So if first you close off under exp, and this gives you the exponential ordered field T exp, also known as exponential trans series. And then in another step, well, on this T exp, it's an exponential ordered field, but the exponential map is not onto, so you need to close off on the logarithms, and so that's what you do in the second step. Okay, and so the result is that you get, as I said, a directed union of ordered abelian groups starting with x to the r, and an exponentiation map on this directed union, corresponding directed union of Hahn fields. Okay, so I won't go into the details of the construction because that would take too long, but one can get a good idea of what's going on by looking at sample computation. How do you exponentiate a trans series? Well, you can take your trans series F, you write it in the following way. You first split off the terms where all the monomials are infinite, so to speak. Yeah, they're bigger than 1, so that's the G. Then the C is the constant term, and then there's the epsilon, which is, so to speak, infinitesimal. And then, the exponential map is supposed to be transforming addition into multiplication, so this means that e to the f is supposed to be e to the g times e to the c times e to the epsilon. Now, e to the epsilon, because epsilon to the n over n factorial is summable in T, for that I can simply use the usual Taylor formula for the exponential function. E to the c, well, c is a real number, so that has meaning just as a real number. And e to the g, well, this is going to be a new trans monomial. So you see that somehow there's an inductive construction here by which you adjoin these new e to the g's step by step to make the exponential function more and more defined. And for logarithms, the story is a bit different. Logarithms also may create new trans monomials. But I'm not going to go into that. Okay, so here are a few features of this field. So the first one is that by the construction, it doesn't contain elements that have arbitrarily nested exponentials or logarithms. So somehow this is a feature of the inductive construction. So these kind of things are not allowed. Moreover, the iterates of e to the x are co-final in t, and the iterates of log are co-initial among the positive infinite elements. And well, this field has a lot of additional structures. For example, you can substitute one trend series into another one. So if you have a trend series g, positive infinite, then you can substitute g for x in f in a natural way. So you can form f of g of x. So one way to state this precisely is to say that there's a unique operation, fg goes to f composed with g, such that for all g, the map f goes to f composed g is a strongly linear embedding of exponential ordered fields, and x is well, the neutral element. And then, in fact, it turns out that if you restrict this operation to the positive infinite elements, you also have compositional inverses, so you get a group. Okay, more structure. So there's not just composition, not just exponentiation and composition, but there is also a derivation. So one short way to say this is that there is a unique strongly linear derivation on t, which gives x derivative 1 and is compatible with exponentiation. So the chain rule holds for exponentiation. Well, this was defined by Ikal, who first introduced the trend series. and then the details were worked out in this paper by Venetris, McIntyre, and Marker. So in this talk, my main interest is going to be in T as a differential field with this particular derivation. okay, so I used the usual notation for higher derivatives. So here are some properties of this derivation. So the constant field of this derivation is the reals. So this is not obvious, right? This is something that needs to be proved. The chain rule holds not just for exponentiation, as it's stipulated here, but it also holds for for composition in the sense that I introduced it in the previous slide. And a lot of differential equations have solutions in T. So for example, every F has an antiderivative in T. Now, in fact, we now, I think, have a good understanding of what kind of things are what kind of differential equations have solutions in T or not, because of the following theorem, the model completeness of T. So let's view T as a model theoretic structure where we single out the usual arithmetic operations, the derivation, the ordering, and also this dominance relation. And then this is our theorem, that in this, using this language, T is model complete. Okay, so I should say here that the inclusion of this dominance relation might seem a little bit random, but in fact it is necessary for this theorem to be true. well, model complete is just a weak statement, but in fact we do have also a quantifier elimination statement in the natural definitional expansion of the language that I introduced above. But the upshot is that overall we have a basic understanding of the definable sets in T, thanks to this theorem. But to get some more insight into the nature of these definable sets, one should, as usual in model theory, introduce a notion of dimension. So this is what I want to explain now, the dimension of definable sets in T. Okay, so the notion of dimension that I want to use is simply the naive topological dimension. So for this, I equip T with the order topology and H T to the N with the corresponding product topology. And then here's some notation. So if you have a set, subset S of T to the N and the permutation of the of 1 through n, then s to the sigma is the set obtained by permuting the coordinates according to this permutation sigma among the elements of S. And then pi m is the projection onto the first m coordinates. And then the dimension of a non-empty definable set is the largest m such that the projection onto m of S sigma has non-empty interior for some permutation. So another way to say this is that you pick m coordinates and you project onto those coordinates. I did this here with the first using the permutation and then projecting onto the first m coordinates. It's the same thing. Okay, and well, this is for a non-empty set. For the empty set, I define dimension to equal infinity. And it turns out that this notion of dimension has very nice properties, and it can be characterized in, it's very robust, it can be characterized in a number of equivalent ways. And particularly important are the zero-dimensional sets. So let's say we have a definable non-empty set. Well, when does it have dimension zero? Well, finite sets, of course, have dimension zero. But also the constant field has dimension equal to zero. And in fact, one can show that the dimension of this definable set equals zero precisely if S is discrete in the order topology. The proof of this equivalence uses really the full machinery of our model completeness proof. And it also uses another characterization of dimension in terms of differential algebra, which I won't mention here, but this is one of the things that's in the background here. And in fact, one of the consequences is that if you have a solution set of a differential equation, it will automatically be of dimension zero in one variable. Yeah, so here's something that goes in this direction. Namely that if in any ambient space, if the dimension of S is less than n, then this means that S is contained, can be captured by the zero set of some differential polynomial, non-zero differential polynomial. Question? Sorry?
Differential varieties are discrete?
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Well, I mean, it can also be a subset of such, but. Okay, so here are some more properties of dimension. I think, you know, for people who use dimensions, these are all very natural. For example, the second one, which is the dimension formula, that if you have a definable map, then the dimension of the image can not be larger of the dimension of the set S. And you have a formula for the dimension. If you know that the dimension of all the all the fibers are constant. So this is given here. And I stress here that you know, this the set of elements Y such that the fiber above Y has a fixed dimension is definable with the same parameters, because this is useful technically. And then the last property is also something that's well known from, let's say, dimension in O-minimal structures, namely that the dimension of the frontier of a definable set is strictly smaller than the dimension of S. Okay, so let me give you it turns out that just having a notion of dimension with all these properties is already pretty useful for proving things. So here's a nice little application. So if you have a semi-algebraic function, we know, you know, that they're polynomially bounded at infinity. But using property 2, this dimension property, you can easily show that if you have a definable function in T, then it's ultimately bounded by an iterate of the exponential function. The argument is quite easy. So the graph of your definable function is in definable bijection to T itself, right? So it has dimension 1. It's a subset then of T squared of strictly smaller dimension. So by what I said before, this means there's a differential polynomial that captures the graph of this definable function. And then you can use some results that we had about zeros of the size of zeros of differential polynomials to get this bound quite easily. And some people in the audience here believe that one should actually be able to replace this also by a power bound here. But we are not sure about that yet. Okay. Right. So back to the zero-dimensional sets. It seems that it's important to know what they look like. So here is one little observation, although it's not very useful. but if you have a dimension zero set, then you can show that there is an injective map sending the set into T, a definable injective map. This is basically the primitive element theorem or some variant of that in differential algebra. But really, what more can you say about zero-dimensional S? And it turns out that a theorem of Herwig, Rushovsky, and McPherson, together with the following fact, which always puzzled us a bit, gives rise to an answer to this question. And this is the following fact here, which is a byproduct of our model completeness proof. So if you have an extension of models of the theory of T, which have the same constant field, and you have a differential polynomial from this little field K, then it does not get any additional zeros in L.
And why the univariants?
Probably, but no.
One variable. Non-zero polynomial.
Yes. Oh yeah. Of course, it's yes. Non-zero polynomial in one variable. Yes. Yeah. Okay, and so then using this theorem of Herwig-Rushovsky-McPherson in combination with this corollary gives you a nice characterization of dimension zero sets, namely those that turn out to be those that are fiberable by constants. So what is this concept of fiberable by constants? So we say that a definable set is fiberable by constants in zero steps if it's finite, and it's fiberable by constants in r plus 1 steps if there is a definable map going from S to R such that the pre-images are fiberable by constants in R steps. The fibers are all fiberable by constants in R steps. And then we say that S is fiberable by constants if it is fiberable by constants in some number of steps. Yeah, so that's why I say almost, because really, to make this precise, you should work in an omega-saturated model. And what this is here is a very precise version of co-analyzability. Okay, so let me also give you a few applications of this. So T, as an ordered field, has a completion. Yeah, completion as an ordered field. I can also think of this as, again, as a subfield of the Hahn field over the transmonomial group. Then the derivation on T is continuous, so it extends uniquely to a continuous derivation on the completion. And one of the consequences of our model completeness proof is that T is an elementary substructure of the completion. So now let's think about the structure consisting of the completion with a predicate for T. So let me introduce this new language. And so then, in fact, one can describe the first order theory of this pair in the following way. Namely, the theory is given for pairs KF is given by the following facts. You say that K and F are elementarily equivalent to T. F is not equal to K. And F is dense in K. And this axiomatizes the complete theory of the pair consisting of the completion and T. And in fact, this theory also turns out to be model complete. And well, this uses the results on zero dimensional sets and also some work of Fournier-Serou. Okay, so this is one application of this study of zero-dimensional sets. Here is another one. One can lift the Euler characteristic from the reals to zero-dimensional definable sets. So here's one way to make this precise. So there's a unique assignment that sends a discrete definable set to an integer, which satisfies all the axioms for the Euler characteristic restricted to discrete definable sets. Right, so chi of S union S2 is chi of S1 union S2 is chi of S1 plus chi of S2 for disjoint discrete definable sets. And also if you have a definable map where the domain is discrete and the fibers have all constant Euler characteristic, then you have a formula for the Euler characteristic of S. Right, and this is a consequence of fiberability because the fiberability basically allows you to, and the fact that you have this, you want to preserve this formula allows you to show that you can lift the Euler characteristic from the reals, semi-algebraic sets in the reals, to discrete definable sets. I should also say that another thing that we know is that the induced structure on R is just a semi-algebraic structure. Okay, and then, a neat little application here is that no definable subset of T has order type omega because of Euler characteristic. And one can also play the same game with lifting the dimension. So the semi-algebraic dimension can also be lifted to a dimension of zero dimensional sets. So there's another dimension, a finer dimension, if you like, that that can be lifted. Okay, so now let me talk about the strong automorphisms of T. So this is related to this dimension business in the following way. So if you think about it, fiberability by constants in one step is really like internality to the reals. Yeah. So, where I here use the following definition for internal. So S is internal to R if there is a definable map from some R to the M into T to the N, such that the image of this map contains my set S. And then, it's a natural question, right? I mean, to see whether there are examples of sets that are, fiberable in two steps, but not fiberable in one step, right? In other words, not internal to R. Here is such an example. So this, I think, is, I mean, in DCF0, this is also, a well-known example, but it also works in our context. So if you look at this differential equation, the solutions in T look like this. These are R times e to the sx. So these are all these exponentials. And this set is fibrable by constants in two steps, yeah, because what you do is you simply take the logarithmic derivative of such a thing. That gives you a real number, and the fibers are also given by real numbers. So it's fibrable by constants in two steps, but we can show that it's not internal to the reals. And the way that you do that is quite explicitly using automorphisms. So you can show that if you have a countable subset of T, then you find an automorphism. And if you have any countable subset of T, you can find an automorphism fixing that countable set and moving these guys. Right, and so to show this in a rigorous way, you exploit this group of strong automorphisms of T. So what is a strong automorphism of T? Well, it's a differential field automorphism, sigma, which is strongly linear, but whose inverse is also strongly linear. Now, I'm...
K is T,
sorry, yes, yeah. I don't know why this is suddenly K, but yeah, this should be T. Right, I'm including this here, but in fact, in the end, it will turn out to be superfluous. So it will turn out to be that any sigma will automatically be, the inverse will also be strongly linear. But it's not clear from just on general grounds. OK, so here's the description of all the strong automorphisms of T. So let's say you have an additive map from T to R, which vanishes on the valuation ring. In other words, the convex hull of the reals in T. So I denote this here by T less than. And yeah, so let me take such an alpha, and let me also take a real number C. Then with this data, there is a unique strongly linear automorphism of T, which has the following properties. It sends x to x plus c, and it commutes in the following way with exponentiation. So sigma of e to the f is e to the alpha f plus sigma f for all f. Okay, and in fact, every strongly linear automorphism of T arises in this way from a unique pair alpha and c. So somehow the alpha and the c together describe all the automorphisms. Now, why is this plausible? Well, let's say we have a strongly linear automorphism and some f in T. Well, both sigma of e to the f and e to the sigma of f are solutions of the differential equation y prime over y equals sigma f prime, right? So they should differ by a positive constant, right? And this positive constant is captured by this e to the alpha of f. So this is why the alpha comes in. And also, why does the alpha vanish on the valuation ring? Well, let's say you have an infinitesimal f. Well, then, as I explained, e to the f is given by the Taylor series of the exponential function. But sigma is strongly linear, right? So sigma of e to the f is then given by sigma of f to the n over n factorial. In other words, it's given by e to the sigma of f. So this means that if I take an f, which is infinitesimal, then the alpha, the coefficient that I have to put in the front test has to equal 1. So, so this is why we have this thing here, alpha vanishing. OK, so now you can dress this up a little bit and define two groups, namely the first subgroup of sigma odd would be M. So these are all the automorphisms which commute with the exponential function. So we call this the monodromic group. And then a T, which are all those things which are the identity on X. And then from my description, it's not hard to see that then you get a description of the group as a semi-direct product of T with M. right, and yeah, and this T, well, the M obviously is a commutative group, but the T, well, it is related to the collection of all homomorphisms from T to R, additive maps from T to R, which vanish on the valuation ring, right, by sending such a additive map to the corresponding automorphism, which you know, is given by this alpha. But so this group here is commutative, but this is not a group morphism. So this means the T, you know, the curly T here is not a commutative group. Right. So there, in fact, there's a co-cycle hiding here. If you want to describe this more precisely. Okay. So here are some byproducts of the proof of this theorem. So as I mentioned, you know, the inverse of a strongly linear automorphism of T is automatically strongly linear, right? So somehow that I included the inverse in the definition was in retrospect was not necessary. Also, every strongly linear embedding of T into itself is surjective. And here, strongly linear embedding means as differential fields. Okay. Another consequence is about respecting the decomposition of T. Right. So T has a canonical decomposition. So the violation ring has a canonical complement, namely it's given all those trans series who support, all the transmonomials in the support are bigger than one. So we have this canonical complement here. Now, sigma, any automorphism of T has to respect the evaluation ring, right? Because it's the convex hull of the reals. So it has to respect this, but not necessarily the complement. So you can ask which automorphisms respect the complement. And in fact, there's a nice description of that. A sigma respects this complement precisely if it respects, well, all, you know, more or less the transmonomial group, also with positive real coefficients, if and only if it is the identity on all the iterated logarithms. So if you have a sigma which is the identity on all the iterated logarithms, then this means that it respects this complement. Okay, now once you have this group, you know, you can establish in the usual way a Galois connection, right? So for every f, you can look at all the, you know, for every subset or subfield, you can look at the group of all the automorphisms which fix everybody in that field. And conversely, if you have a subgroup of G, you can look at the fixed field. So this would be all the f in k, such that it's sigma of f is equal to f for all sigma in G. And this, these are fixed point sets, so it's a strong differential subfield of K.
K is T.
Yeah, I don't know. Yes, sorry. Yeah, it's K is T, yes. Okay, now, why is this interesting? Well, if you have a G and you look at this fixed field here, this strong differential subfield, it's definably closed in T. So this gives you a way of producing interesting definably closed subsets of T. And since we don't really have at the moment a good understanding of the definable closure in T, this is kind of interesting because it gives you ways of constructing examples. So here is a list of differential subfields that you can show are definably closed. So basically all the, you know, kind of natural differential subfields that you can imagine turn out to be definably closed. So for example, if you look at the Hahn field generated by let's say n plus one iterated exponentials or by n plus one iterated logarithms, so that would be a definably closed subfield, differential subfield. Also T-exp, the differential field of exponential trans series, which arises in the construction of T, as I mentioned. So that can be shown to be definably closed. Also T-log, which is the union of all these RL0, LN. And well, here we have allowed real coefficients, but I can also restrict to rational coefficients. So T log Q, right, so that can also be shown to be definably closed. And well, in that case, I can, well, in each case, there is a group that whose fixed field is the corresponding field. But here, in this case, I can actually write it down easily, namely the group meet exactly all those sigma which are the identity on the iterated logarithms. It's clear that, well, one inclusion here is clear, but the other one you have to prove. Okay. Well, and then the natural question, right? I mean, somehow it would be nice if there was a sort of a differential Galois correspondence that would allow us to describe the fixed fields of subgroups of this group in an explicit way. I think in general this is a bit difficult, but for some cases one could give an answer. So, for example, if you look at only subgroups of L, right? So these are again the sigma which vanish on which are the identity on all the iterated logarithms. Then you can describe the fixed fields of subgroups of L. In an explicit way, so they are the strong differential subfields of T, where the multiplicative group has a decomposition like this, right? So first the reals, and then some divisible subgroup of the transmonomial group which contains X and is closed under log and such that this field is closed under logarithms. Okay, yeah. So as I said, in general, I think this description is kind of difficult. I did try a little bit to do this for subfields of T log Q, and in fact one can do it, but it becomes much more involved algebraically. And I think this talk has been going on for too long anyway, so thank you.